Welcome to week five. We are a little bit past the midpoint here in our class, so we are doing well. We're in good shape. A few things to note for this week. And again, right away, Fireside Chat, this is meant to be informal. And it's, so take everything and just, imagine that, we're having a discussion right now. It's kind of like at the end of a class period and just, getting some experiences that we've had, we're sharing, getting some of that information out there. So, the real meat is going to be within the course material, but I'm going to try to, every week provide a little context and a little bit of, from my experiences to give you some perspective and for me to share any tips I can. So we talk about English language learners. I used to post a lot here about CALPS and BIC, and those are synonyms, they're acronyms, but the different ELL bulletins and stuff like that. But really, just the DPI webpage has what you need. And all of the CISAs now are very thorough in having staff trained in ELL support. And that's a service that they provide to districts. So especially if you're starting out and you're experiencing increasing English language learner population, your CISA will be able to help you out and work with neighboring districts, ask them, how are you doing this? So one of the things that you want to be very aware of if you're a student services director is if you start to see a change in the English language learner population of your school. So let's say it starts to grow, or you didn't have one and all of a sudden now you have one, and people are thinking, it's a language area, so we're going to refer for special education. So got to make sure people are aware that, just because English is not your native language doesn't mean you get referred for, learning disability and reading. But that does happen. That does happen because the ELL supports aren't in place and people don't know what to do. About 20 years ago, a district that I interned in was going through that. They had an influx of English language learners and they're going through a lot of cultural changes in the community. But they ended up having just this flood of referrals for special education. And it was students, who had been in the United States for a month or two. And, again, it was done because they didn't have an ELL program in place. And they thought, we'll use special education. But I think, for the most part, we've evolved beyond that. But if you do sense that happening, just make sure that you have ELL and special education and clearly identify what the differences are. Universal design for learning, I recommend, whenever you can, send staff to trainings on UDL. It's going to benefit all students. And here's something about staff trainings I think is interesting. One, as a director, and I looked at everything that all the professional development staff had attended in the last 2 years. And most of it was like autism and reading. But we also had, needs like in math and trauma-informed care, in English language, learners and so forth. Yet, no one was really going to those trainings. People were going to the trainings that they had already been to 10 autism trainings, and they had already been to, 8 behavior trainings and kind of doing the same thing over and over, yet our needs, where we really needed people to get training, we weren't sending people. People are, again, in the groove of, hey, I like going to this conference. So that's where you need to look and say, we need to make sure our training is, we're sending people to the areas where they need to be trained and not the areas where they're kind of the most comfortable already. Review the homeless, the materials I have on homelessness, and the county, has a responsibility with that too. But homelessness, when you have a student that is homeless, and transportation requirements. I mean, I indicate in the weekly reflection, you know, that's a Nike, that's a just do it. I mean, you don't even get into a debate about that. So, you know, some people won't understand, well, you know, why do we have to transport the student from across district lines to whatever, you know, if they're homeless? And I mean, you just do. So make sure, you know, that you follow the McKinney-Vento Act. You know, I have a link to that. Again, people will, if you don't already know this, go to somebody, a neighboring, you know, district, or someone that has already done this and sit down and have them kind of walk you through it. That's going to be the best way. And CESA7 has a terrific ELL portion of their website. And I encourage you to look at the, go to the Create Wisconsin conference. That's in Green Bay every year, although they hold it in different spots. Culturally Responsive Education. I don't know what the rest stands for, but that's really a terrific training conference on, you know, how to work with a ever-growing diverse population of students. So Create Wisconsin, if you Google that, you'll find the website. And again, I would take a team and go to the conference. The big conference is held every spring in Green Bay, across from the airport. So there's something happening too under Obamacare that you need to be aware of. So nonprofit hospitals now are not for profit. So probably like where you are, almost guaranteed, some of your hospitals or medical facilities around you or your students are receiving care. But right around you, those facilities, they're having to do a community health needs assessment, or CHNA, or a China report, basically they call it. But that's new for the hospitals. They haven't had to do that before. And I think it's every 2 or 3 years they have to do it. But if you go online and you start, again, Googling hospitals in your area plus CHNA, or, you know, needs assessment, you're going to see that they've done this, and they've probably already contacted your school district and have your school district be a part of it. But they need to go out and identify needs in the community, such as, are their kids not having, you know, their innate needs met, or dental needs not being met, or are we not addressing, you know, mental health support for adults, or depression, or things like that. I mean, things that are going to affect your families and your kids. What is nice about that is it's coming from the hospital side to the school side. I mean, you know it. Most of the times the school has to lead the charge in building the relationships with the outside, but the hospitals, they're obligated to do this. So you can find those reports and, you know, make sure then you reach out and you make that connection. And when that next report is done, that you are a member, you know, sitting at the table when that's generated. But it's some really wonderful information that they can also give you on your demographics, and then also from a medical standpoint, some of what they're seeing. Things that, yeah, I mean, if you were to take this and compile it on your own, it would take immense amount of time. So again, CHNA, or the Community Health Needs Assessment, be aware of that. And that's something too that I would make sure I would share out with my counselors and my psychs, and probably even take it and share it out with your school board, or have someone come in from the hospital and do that. What I think it also does is it supports you in stating that, hey, our student population is changing. Sometimes you have school boards where members will say, you know, it wasn't that way when I was in school. I don't know why we're doing this and this and this and this. And, you know, the fact is it's different. I mean, we know it. It's changing. But if you can have somebody come in and, you know, present something that, you know, you haven't done, that's been done on the outside, that's local, you know, I think it has a lot of influence. Disproportionality. So around a lot of the metro areas, Madison, Milwaukee, you'll see districts being identified as disproportionate, for example, in identifying African-American students with emotional behavioral disabilities or suspended versus their white counterparts. And I think in Wisconsin, I don't know, last year, like 35 districts were identified by the DPI and required to do corrective action plans. But you want to look at your suspension data, or I would say your discipline referral data, your special education referral data for EBD and OHI, and then, you know, kind of cross-reference that against race and see if you are, you know, is it more likely for an African-American student to be suspended in your school or referred to the office? Now, one of the things about suspensions, and I talk about this in my OCR presentation, so I don't want to get too much into it, but I think suspension data is useless because schools know how to get around suspension data. They use abeyance agreements, they use change to IP without, change to placement by using the IP, pre-expulsions, all things like pre-expulsions you don't have to report out, abeyance agreements you don't have to report out anywhere. So to, you know, sometimes there's districts that will not suspend students, but do a de facto suspension that's not reported. Again, be transparent in what you're doing. So if you are, in fact, suspending a white student, but for an African-American student, you do an abeyance agreement, you know, that's not appropriate. So you need to identify that, and you need to say, whatever we do needs to be consistent. I mean, if you're doing an abeyance agreement for each, well, you know, that's fine, I guess. But, you know, you don't want to treat one population different than the other just because you're afraid if the numbers show up at the EPI, you're going to get tagged again as disproportionate, or people are going to go online and see, you know, that your district has X number of suspensions compared to the previous, you know, another district nearby. Board members will ask, you know, no one wants to see that a district is suspending students. So, there's a lot of pressure to not suspend, and principals will say that to me, that they've had pressure from up above to not suspend, especially not suspend minority students. I have some materials from Professor Diana Thundercloud, and she's a friend of mine, a wonderful instructor, just a terrific person. She's Native American, and the materials that I share from her really talk about white privilege, not so much about like Native American culture, but there's one activity, it's a waste paper basketball game type thing. It's actually, I've done it, it's really good for a conversation starter. Now, right off the bat, some of you might not agree with what I've shared as far as, you know, like the white privilege, and, you know, some people just don't believe that, you know, white privilege is present, or that white privilege is something that needs to be addressed. That really, you know, the greater issues are just that we need to get to the core roots of making sure that we have innate needs of people, you know, met and things like that. And I'm not here to debate you one way or another. I'm just saying that there are discussions that go on about white privilege, and those discussions Diana really covers well in her materials. And if you want to have that just to foster some discussions, go ahead and do that. But again, I'm not here to take a position, you know, one way or another. I'm just trying to give you some resources. One of the things that you want to make sure that you have too, we talked about, you know, ELL, and I want to come back. Make sure that you know where to go in case you need interpreters. So if someone moves into your district and, you know, they're from Russia or whatever, you know, and as they have three kids and speak Russian, or I don't know if there's a language spoken that's in Russia, but you want to know who you can call and have an interpreter come in. If you need to do an assessment, you know, to find out where the student is at, or even if there's you need that person there for a while to help the student or students get situated. Typically through immersion, you know, students will pick up language pretty quick, but And if you do a special education eval at some point and a student's, you know, native language is Spanish or something, you know, like that. Madison Schools, I believe, has like 130 languages that are spoken in the district, you know, families. But you want to make sure then that you have some means to bring in somebody to administer within that native language. If not, that you've made the absolute best attempt to do that. And the time to do that is not when somebody moves in, but it's ahead of time to say, how's it been done in the past? And then also asking around to your other cohorts and you know, things like that to really, or your CISA, or, you know, have that ready to go, because you want to get that figured out ahead of time, at least who are the people that you can start to go to immediately in a situation like that. Again, one of the things I want to come back to, and then we'll wrap it up for this lecture. I don't know, lecture. It's a fireside chat. We got a fire going over here. So, this is a short one, though. You know, your administrators are going to act in the best interests of the student, and you need to back your administrator, and definitely publicly back your administrator. The well-being of a student. What is the well-being, best interest of a student? Nobody knows. There was a research team that studied 60 legal cases. And out of the 60 legal cases, the crux was about best interest of the child. Every case came out with a different interpretation. The feds leave it to the state to define. The state usually comes up with something, or they just pass it on to the district, and the district then either defines it or they pass it on to the principal. But the number one key is act in the best interest of the child. If you do that and you believe that you are doing that, that's going to give you a strong foundation if you ever are challenged down the road. And again, if you know your principal has done something where they believe they acted in the best interest of the child, and in retrospect, you know, maybe something could have been handled a different way, you back that principal and have those discussions of, you know, maybe what are some other options that we could have, you know, you could have done or looked at or whatever, but you do not criticize or be critical of people for doing something that they believe is in the best interest, you know, of the child. So you need people to be able to do that. So this was a short one, relatively speaking. Have a good week 5, and I will see you again in week 6.